Hello and greetings from Berlin, Germany. It is an honor to be presenting this keynote for you today, and I hope that it will inspire some ideas and maybe even discussions throughout the festival. I was invited to talk about the future of Open GLAM, which is, to be honest, not quite an easy task, because galleries, libraries, archives, and museums already constitute quite a broad field. And then there's also the problem of talking about the future in general, because the future will never be exactly as we envision it today. And still, keeping this in mind, I decided to, first of all, structure my presentation alongside the three main aspects of openness in relation or in the context of GLAM. And these are open access, open data, and open source. And building on that, I propose to look at the idea of openness on a broader level and use this understanding as a vantage point to highlight some of the aspects that might become even more relevant in the future. So to start, let us have a look at what open access refers to in the context of GLAM most of the time. Open access quite generally refers to the act of publishing digital surrogates or digital reproductions of cultural heritage, like books, artworks, museum objects, archival material, and so on, under an open access license, for example, a Creative Commons license. And a truly free culture license allows the public to not only view the material, but to share it, to reuse it, to modify it. And ideally, the digital content is also published together with metadata or data relating to the collection as a whole. And generally, a free culture license can be used for the digital surrogates of cultural heritage that is already in the public domain. So the main argument here is that if cultural heritage already is in the public domain, also its digital copies or representations must remain in the public domain, including the metadata. And you'll find many resources, webinars, articles, and so on the web that already cover many of the very important main aspects of Open GLAM, such as the basics and benefits of open access principles, copyright and licensing, or good practice examples. And such resources are, for example, published by the Open Knowledge Foundation, Wikimedia, the Creative Commons Organization, or Europeana, just to name a few. So go out there and have a look. But what I want to focus on today are the following questions. First, how can we deal with media-specific challenges in digitization? And two, what is the value of low-scale efforts? So basically, what can we do if we cannot digitize and openly publish the entirety of our collection? Why should we bother at all? But first, let me give you some basic information about the background of the use case that I'm about to present to you. So this is an example that I worked on in the context of Museum 4.0, a project at the Prussian Cultural Heritage Foundation. And one aspect of the project was that we should explore the potentials of games and gamification in the context of cultural mediation practices. And one of the underlying principles of that part of the project was that we could only use already existing digitized cultural heritage material that, of course, needed to be published as open access material. So what I started with was to basically look around to see what the what material we could use and what material would lend itself to being turned into a game. And then I came across a project at the State Library in Berlin that was just finishing up a feasibility study regarding the digitization of movable books, such as pop-up books or other paper-engineered objects. And what my colleagues from the State Library had done in their study was that they had looked at the different interaction techniques that were used in the movable books. And then they try to figure out a way how to also preserve that interactivity in the digital surrogates. And they ended up with using game engines to do so. And this way, they were able to recreate the movable parts and possible interactions of the original books. And the results of their project were then published under open access principles, which consequently allowed us to reuse the material and create something completely new out of it. And I will show you what we did with the material. We decided to create an actual browser game for kids based on the digitized material. And what you see here is the intro to that game, or the final game prototype that we created. And here the main game characters are introduced in the narrative, which is that the books are falling apart and the kids now must retrieve and secure the missing parts to repair the books. And here you see some of the gameplay in the finished prototype. And for this use case, we teamed up with a game designer and a programmer and started to work in an iterative and user-centered design and development process. And this means that we consulted the target audience, which was kids between the ages of 6 and 10, right from the beginning, as you can see in this image here. We were open for their ideas, we listened to their input and learned a lot that helped us further down the line. For example, they voted on their favorite designs for the robots and shared their ideas regarding the story and narrative of the game. So as you see, apart from the open access principles, openness as a mindset played a significant role in the process of developing this game. And also the game designer and the programmer had to be open towards accepting limitations, what could be done with the material, for example. And these were not limitations due to a limited license. Because it was open access, we could have done anything with it. But we wanted to make sure that the original material remained visible and valued, and that there would also be an aspect of learning included in the game. And also, it was important for us that our colleagues from the library would agree with what we did there, because the merging and mixing of historical artifacts and born digital game elements was a bit unusual for them at first. But presenting our designs and ideas on a regular basis and valuing their input, we were able to convince them to be open towards this idea. And in the end, the result really convinced them as well. And the last aspect that I want to mention here is openness towards the imperfect. You see, the game was developed on quite a small budget and only serves as a first prototype. It is by all means not finished and is not perfect. And there are so many aspects that I would like to improve and continue working on. But that is okay, because its purpose was to illustrate the potential of open access and creative reuse, and consequently to encourage others to take a similar approach. And additionally, the game will be published under an open source license, together with documentation material about the production process that will be published under an open access principle. So it hopefully will also inspire and inform other projects in the long run. So what are the main takeaways here? Well, digitization sometimes requires openness towards new technologies and methods. And secondly, also smaller quantities count. Just a few selected objects can make a difference and inspire something that might bring a completely new audience in contact with a collection. It is worth it, and it can also be done on a smaller scale. There already is quite a lot of material digitized out there, and following an open access strategy with that material is really a good and rewarding way to go about, no matter the quantity. So for our next aspect, let's look at what open data means in the context of GLAM today. when talking about open data, in the focus mainly lies on publishing collections in machine readable or machine actionable or interoperable forms and formats. So this part is about making collections available as data. Although this aspect is sometimes also subsumed under the general term open access, I actually prefer to look at it in its own right. And what I want to focus on in the next part of my presentation is the potential of open data and why we should work towards making even more GLAM collections available in an interoperable and machine readable, or rather in a machine actionable form. And I will shortly point out the three main arguments that I personally find most compelling. So first of all, GLAM institutions historically have always provided research and teaching with material. Libraries, archives, museums play a significant role in providing many researchers and disciplines with original and historical content records on a broad range of topics. Now, especially with the diversification of methods and techniques used to conduct research, there is a growing need for data. And by making collections available as data, GLAM institutions directly support research and teaching in many different disciplines, even disciplines that we might not connect with GLAM and cultural heritage at once. So there is a huge potential and also a responsibility of GLAM institutions, in my opinion, to publish their collections as data for purposes of research and teaching. The second aspect is the facilitation of aggregation. So by publishing collections as open, interoperable, and by using standardized communication protocols, we directly support the goals of large-scale aggregation of collections, even globally. So there are already large aggregation platforms like Europeana that works towards this goal on a European level. But also by publishing collections as data, we open our material up to being part of the linked open data universe. And lastly, publishing collections as open data supports creative reuses, remixing, or artistic approaches on a broader scale. There is a growing interest in digital and computational art, and art and cultural production have always been influenced by and by building on existing expressions and material. So by publishing collections as data, we make them available and more accessible also for new forms of artistic expression. And in my view, this constitutes quite an important aspect that might even continue or contribute to keeping collections relevant, alive, and connected to contemporary topics in the future. So let's proceed with the last of the three aspects of openness in the context of GLAM, which is open source. So first of all, open source allows you to reuse applications that others have created. So if you plan to produce a digital application, it is advisable to first look around you, because quite often you will find somebody has already created something that comes quite close to what you're planning to do. So looking for an existing open source solution first, before starting from scratch, can save you time and money. This nonetheless doesn't mean that open source means that it comes without any costs at all, because most of the time you do need to implement the source code or application adapted to your specific needs or update certain aspects of it. The second side of open source is the production of applications yourself and publishing them with an open source license, so that they then can be freely reused by others. And this is actually a very valuable and very rewarding aspect of my work that I can just highly recommend for you to consider as well. And to illustrate this potential, I will show you one of the results of a project that I worked on a few years ago. And this project was called VICUS, Visualizing Cultural Collections at the University of Applied Sciences in Potsdam. And in this project, we developed a research prototype that you see running here in the background that contextualizes digitized collections alongside time and topics and allows for an up-close exploration of the individual objects and their metadata. So originally, we created this visualization for a collection of drawings and sketches that were created by the Prussian King Frederick William IV, which you see here when we zoom in a bit. And what we then realized was that the basic functionalities of our visualization also could be applied to other collections. So basically what the visualization does is that it displays up to 10,000 objects at once on a timeline. And the objects have to be connected to at least one topic or tag, which is then also used for the filter as at the top that you just saw. So when I now select a search term, all the items connected to that term are displayed above the timeline. So I can see kind of how they are distributed over time. And then I can, as you can see there, zoom in to the high resolution images. And also the timeline can be annotated with additional information. And since we were using the drawings made by Frederick William, these information on the timeline relate to his life and to political or historical things that happened during his lifetime, which then can also be connected to the images, like his preoccupation with biblical images during the Wars of Liberation and Napoleon, whom he frequently painted as the devil himself. So we then published our research prototype under an open source license, and I've displayed the link to the visualization interface itself and to the GitHub repository on this slide at the right side. And I'm very glad to see that what was originally just a one-off research prototype has now been developed into a reusable visualization tool by my colleague Christopher Peach, who was responsible for the design and development of our prototype. And also this visualization framework, as you can see, is now being used by quite a number of institutions to display their collections online in a similar manner. And the continuous development and adaptation to the needs of different collections led also to the adding of new features that we hadn't thought of while we were working on it. And this is also being done by other projects and initiatives, like, for example, a geo-visualization feature that allows you to place the items, the objects on a map, or a video feature that allows you to include not only images, but also videos that can be viewed directly in the visualization interface. So this is just one example of how open source can be a very rewarding way to share your work and results with others. Well, now we've already seen the three main aspects where openness plays a role in the present and in the future of open GLAM: open access, open data, and open source. And I've already mentioned that I would like to look at openness on a broader and more general level. So what I mean by that is, and what I've mentioned a few times throughout this presentation already, is that I suggest to understand openness as a mindset. And apart from the very specific areas of openness that we've covered so far, there are many more areas that can profit from an open approach. So what are these? Approaching how we work, how we communicate, and how we interpret and mediate cultural heritage with an open mindset will play an even bigger role in terms of how GLAM institutions will remain relevant also in the future. So, what are the main aspects of openness that I connect with this mindset in these areas? So first of all, be an open to trying new technologies, methods, or creative approaches when working in the context of cultural heritage holds a lot of potential. And this can be, for example, done by collaborating with other disciplines, with colleagues from another department, or with peer groups that bring in their own specialized knowledge and expertise. Be open to their expertise, even if it might differ from how you are used to do the things you're used to. And also accept failures, especially when working on things and methods that are new to you. This doesn't mean that your project or your idea has failed as a whole. Be open to accept it as part of a learning process, or even as the basis of every scientific approach. You experiment, you fail, you analyze, you repeat. And this is what learning is all about. And what is important, what's also important, is to reflect upon and to share your insights of that process and that learning process. I know that it's really hard to talk about the things that didn't work out, but by being open about it, you will help others to not repeat the same mistakes as you did. And so they might give it a try and you might profit from their solution for the problem that you have encountered. So creating an atmosphere of openness, also regarding the processes and the ups and downs, will help us all to improve. And this also means that you should be open to listen and to learn to others, learn from others and listen to them, what they have worked on, how could that inform your work, for example. Ask them, learn from them, value their experiences. And this is also true when planning your communication. Listen and learn to the needs of your audience. And this will also help you to be inclusive in how and what you can communicate, not only in the digital, but also as an organization as a whole. And being open to the experiences and knowledges of your audiences, for example, by enabling participation, is also one way to go about that will help you in the long run to include multiple narratives, and in this way diversify interpretation and mediation of cultural heritage in the long run. So of course this is by no means a complete list, and it is very much informed by my own experiences, but in my experiences that I want to share with you today, I understand these aspects as all being connected, and they might guide our way for the future that I really want to see develop. And I'm really excited to learn more about your projects, and I will follow them online. And so this just leaves me with wishing you so much fun and exciting encounters throughout the next few days. And reach out if you have any questions, and we'll see each other soon. I'm sure about that. Thank you.